If you saw part one of this video, you'll know I converted an assembly language ray tracer I wrote from a CPU I designed to x86. I did this in both inline assembly and full assembly. I also covered many aspects of x86 assembly, so you might want to check out part one if you haven't seen it. Here I'll start by improving the look of the code of the inline version. Previously, it was perhaps a little messy because I wanted it to be as close to the original assembly code as possible. But assembly doesn't necessarily translate to nice programming style. So, for those wanting a better coding style, since it is part C, here's how I made the code a little nicer. I created many structures to group together associated variables. This includes various ray tracing oriented data types for colors, vectors, positions, rays, and cameras. I put surface attributes in a structure and created object structures for spheres, planes, and lights. Then I declared and initialized the objects. I did object 2 a little differently in case you prefer it to be more verbose. There's still some perhaps messy variables, but at this point the law of diminishing returns probably applies. You wouldn't really get much out of cleaning those up. In the inline assembly, you can reference the structure elements just as you would in C. However, I'm not aware of any way to specify pointers, so it does seem to have limits. And here's proof this data structure version works. I decided to make a 512 by 512 version of the ray tracer. You can still select the lower resolutions. I also modified it to do a better width-to-height ratio by using 800 by 480, and also added a metallic-looking ball. To create the Fresnel metallic look, I need arc cosine, but there's no arc cosine instruction. So the more indented code will do an arc cosine by using arc tangent. Here's it running. The smaller ball is gold, and the smaller resolutions are available as well. Here's the numerical computation program I wrote for my CPU design. This needs to be linked a little differently because of the getch function I use to wait for one key to be pressed without needing enter to be pressed as well. For Linux, I had to use getchar. You can perhaps use getch from curses or other solutions, but it's more complicated. Here's how I figured out how to link in getch, since it seems to be deprecated. I created a small C test program, then compiled it using the easiest method. Then I used od to look at the generated object file. You can see the linker options that would be necessary to link it. You can also use the strings command. These are Windows versions of Unix commands. I wrote od, but strings came from Microsoft. Their version will also find Unicode strings. Here's it running. This factorial calculator is different than the other one because this one uses arbitrary precision arithmetic, so you can generate numbers far bigger than a 32 or 64-bit integer could store. I'll edit out some of the results for brevity. Here's the Linux version running. It's rather interesting that the text output is faster than in Windows. And now the Mandelbrot and Julia fractal program. I'll skip over most of the color table for brevity. It's not very enlightening, so I won't discuss the source code. I'll just show it running. You can select the scene and the size by pressing the appropriate key. You can also cycle the colors and change the direction and speed of cycling. And naturally, I wrote a 512 by 512 version. Then I decided to see what effect double precision floating point variables would have. Luckily, all that was necessary was to change all floats to doubles. No assembly code had to change. I added this new Mandelbrot location to the menu and set the iteration limit a little higher. Here's the difference between the float and double versions, with both having the same limit. You can see a real difference in the fin areas here. Here's my function plotter program. Keep in mind the tangent function pushes a 1 onto the stack after the result. There's no natural log function, so you need to do this, which is based on this equation. And there's no base 10 log, so you need to do this. And there's no exp function, so you need to do the previously specified power function with e, which is also known as Euler's number or Napier's constant. I don't need to display frames fast with this program, so here I do the message loop the normal way. Here's it running. You can select the function by pressing the appropriate key. It's getting cluttered, so I'll clear it and do the rest. And now the Biorhythm program. Even if you don't believe in biorhythms, and I'm not sure I do, it can provide interesting information like how many days you have lived. At first, I couldn't call sprintf, stringcat, messagebox, etc. without it crashing. So I put those functions in procedures and called those procedures instead. Depending on how the string is declared, whether it's a pointer or an array of characters, you will either have to push the variable or use LEA, putting the result in a register, and then pushing that register, or specify offset when pushing. You can't use parentheses to do the math nicely, so you have to do it in a not as clear way. Here's it running. By the way, that's not my birth date. You can select three different types of biorhythms using the appropriate key. You can also move forward and backward in time. Note the appearance of the OK button. Here's a manifest file. When Microsoft created Windows XP, they wanted nicer common controls, but they also wanted backwards compatibility. So, every program defaults to the old common controls unless it tells the OS to use the newer version by specifying it in its manifest. I usually would link this in by specifying it in a resource file, but this program didn't need a resource file. So here's another tip which you can use with many old programs. If you create a manifest file like this, and name it the same as the executable, but with a .manifest added to the end, and put it in the same directory as the executable, Windows will usually refer to the manifest file you created. It doesn't work for all programs, and sometimes when it does, it's not desirable because the programmer might have designed their program specifically for the old common controls. Notice the OK button is more modern. I figured out how to call C and Windows functions from inline assembly. The reason it crashed was because usually the compiler uses dynamic libraries instead of static libraries. So when the compiler compiles the program, it doesn't know the addresses of the functions in those dynamic libraries, so the calls cause a crash. To solve this, you need to use a pointer to the function by using PTR. Also, the move EBP, ESP and the move ESP, EBP are needed if there are no local variables in the C procedure this inline code is in. Take them out if there are local variables. I don't exactly know why this has to be done. By the way, if you're using C++, you probably will have to specify C-type calling conventions by using extern C. And here's proof the direct call to message box works. Here's just a test program I wrote to try out the integer math functions. Only add, sub, and imul can use immediate values. It doesn't do much. Here's a sample floating point program I got from the internet, more specifically, Wikibooks. It evaluates the law of cosines. It wouldn't assemble. It tries to do a floating point operation that isn't allowed, at least not in my assembler, so I had to make some changes. My version isn't very elegant, perhaps, but at least it works. By the way, the interesting thing here is that the printf uses double precision to print floats, even though the format string is %f. So this is the way to do that. You need to store the value in a quad word and break the quad word up into two double words, pushing them onto the stack. And it calculated the correct result. Here's another tip. If you ever get stuck on how to program x86 assembly, you can use the FA option of the Visual Studio Compiler. This will generate the assembly language file for the C program you compiled. It's not pretty, but it's informative. For GCC, the command would be GCC minus capital S. In case you now think I just did this to all my C programs to create the assembly rather than writing it myself, here's a comparison of my CPU's assembly I wrote versus the new x86 assembly I wrote. You can see it's pretty much the same. By the way, the assembler I wrote for my CPU doesn't require uppercase instructions. I just used uppercase out of tradition. Finally, I figured I would show some of my other assembly language adventures. When I was a kid, I taught myself 6502 assembly and wrote my first assembly language program using a VIC-20. I was writing a graphics editor in BASIC and wanted to do a mirror image function or a flip of some sort. But in BASIC, the mirror image function I wrote was too slow. I replaced the crucial code with a few lines of assembly and it ran a lot faster. The ASL shifts the value to the left, putting the most significant bit into the carry flag. Then the ROR rotates a value to the right, getting the new most significant bit from the carry flag. So this combination, run 8 times, reverses the bits in the byte. In college, I was taught FACTS assembly language. Here's one of the programs I wrote for one of the assignments. I was also taught 68000 assembly in college. And this is a partial printout of one of the programs I wrote with my lab partners. And you already saw some of the assembly I wrote for my CPU design. Well, I guess that's it for now. Here's some useful websites you might want to check out. I put links to these in this video's description area. Happy coding. Please subscribe, like, share, etc. And if you click subscribe, ring the bell to receive notifications of future videos.